Sehr geehrte Damen und Herren, ladies and gentlemen, mesdames et messieurs, my name is David Ehinger. I'm the head of the public affairs section here at the embassy. Es ist mir ein großes Vergnügen, unsere neue Botschafterin, Marie-Gervais Widriker, vorzustellen. And I'd like to invite her to come to the podium and to start off this very special evening here in the Canadian embassy. Merci beaucoup.
Ladies and gentlemen, meine Damen und Herren, Mesdames und Messieurs, dear Douglas Coupland, lieber Herr Gensing, es ist mir eine besondere Freude, Sie heute zu der 7. transmediale Marshall McLuhan Lecture begrüßen zu dürfen. Bienvenue donc à vous tous, et je suis vraiment très content de voir autant de gens dans la salle. Mit der transmediale Marshall McLuhan Lecture, die transmediale Persönlichkeit der kanadischen Kulturszene ein, die in ihrer Arbeit und mit ihrem Denken Marshall McLuhans zeitloses Verständnis für Medien und Technologie um aktuelle Aspekte unserer heutigen Kultur und Gesellschaft erweitern. Tonight I am particularly honored to welcome Douglas Coupland, the renowned Canadian author, artist and designer to the Canadian Embassy and to Transmediale. Welcome, Mr. Coupland. It's really a great pleasure to have you here tonight. Douglas Coupland was born in Germany at the Canadian Forces Base in Baden-Solingen, but grew up in Vancouver, British Columbia. Trained as an artist, he graduated from the Emily Carr University of Art and Design with a focus on sculpture. In the late 1980s, he began writing for magazines, and in 1991, he published his first novel, Generation X, Tales for an Accelerated Culture, which brought him at the very forefront of the literary stage. Since then, Douglas Coupland has published 13 novels, a collection of short stories, 7 nonfiction books, including a biography on Herbert Marshall McLuhan, and a number of dramatic works and screenplays. Reflecting on his becoming a writer, Douglas Coupland has admitted that he became one by accident. He has been quoted saying, "I never wanted to be a writer. Now that I do it, there's nothing else I'd rather do." During the Transmediale, we get the rare chance to encounter him as both Coupland, the thinker and writer at the lecture today, and Coupland as a visual artist. The Or Gallery Berlin is currently presenting his ongoing series of work, Slogans for the Early 21st Century, in which he has made an effort to, as he says, isolate what is already different in the 21st century mind as opposed to the 20th. Tonight, at the Transmediale McLuhan Lecture, we will meet Coupland, the thinker and author. Building on concepts he has recurringly addressed in his novels, such as Microserfs and JPod, and most recently in his biography of McLuhan, Coupland will explore the ultimate fate of our junk data and to where hyperdigitization will lead us. The Marshall McLuhan Salon in the Embassy is once again the venue for the Transmediale and provides a forum for important and innovative projects. Together with the Transmediale, this Saturday, we will be presenting a new edition of the discussion series Mac Illuminations, moderated by Baruch Gottlieb and featuring the Transmediale 2014 residency artists Jamie Allen and David Gauthier. I hope you will get the chance to attend the Maclumination event and to explore the Salon's archive on Marshall McLuhan, which is one of the largest audiovisual archives of the media philosopher outside of Canada, and which will be open during the festival. Obviously, the Embassy is absolutely delighted that the Salon is so sought after as a venue by such important international festivals such as Berlinale and Transmediale. Before closing, I want to underline the exceptional collaboration we have had over the last 7 years with Transmediale, especially with its artistic director, Christopher Gansing. The Embassy is very honored to be such a close partner of this extraordinary festival, and we are very proud to host the transmediale Marshall McLuhan Lecture. Vielen Dank, Herr Gansing. Ihnen allen wünsche ich nun einen spannenden Abend. Mesdames et Messieurs, je vous remercie beaucoup de votre attention. Je vous souhaite à tous une excellente soirée. Merci.
Thank you very much, Ambassador. After this excellent introduction, I will try to be quite brief. It is a true honor to be here again in front of all of you in the Canadian Embassy here in Berlin to present this annual Marshall McLuhan Lecture. This lecture series has evolved into a very important event in the Transmediale Festival as a key kind of pre-conference, the conference that is starting in a couple of days at the Haus der Kultur in der Welt, along with our other extensive programs, film screenings, exhibitions, and so forth. And this year, the thematic of the festival is Afterglow, which, shortly stated, deals with digital culture, the state of digital culture in between trash and treasure. And we're looking at the consequences of the excessive digitization processes that have been ongoing in the past three decades or so, and thinking about this kind of post-digital revolution state where a lot of the utopias that were connected to digital technologies are not perhaps shining so brightly anymore, and we are seeing a lot of real-world negative consequences out of that. But it's not supposed to be a cultural pessimistic theme at the same time. So Afterglow, it departs from this kind of metaphor of a moment of deep twilight where there is dust suspended in the high stratospheres that catches the light of the fading twilight arch below. And this dust is maybe like the digital itself, something that we can't anymore put our fingers on. It's integrated everywhere. But in the Transmediale, we like to think that we need to kind of denaturalize this and kind of examine this dust, this trash of our culture now. So some of the hot topics right now are, for example, the discussions about next internet. Where do we go after big data, after surveillance scandals, and so on? And who will it be that kind of describes and analyzes and reveals the ambiguity of this afterglow moment? I think this is where certainly artists and speculative thinkers can provide visionary approaches beyond the more conventional ones. And this is exactly the kind of approach that we try to devote the yearly Marshall McLuhan Lecture to. So I would like to proceed very soon to welcome Douglas Coupland to the stage, but I would like to thank the Embassy, not only for their generous support, but for being so flexible and cooperative in making this quite extensive program, as was already explained in the framework of the McLuhan program for this year's festival possible. I would like to thank especially the staff members, of course the Ambassador, but also from the Culture and Public Affairs, David Inger, Katharina Fischner, Andrea Bögner, and Susanne Arjang. I hope that we will continue this collaboration also beyond this afterglow. So this brings us finally to Douglas Coupland. And indeed, I don't think we need much of an introduction. We had an excellent introduction already. I would like to say that one of the main inspirations also that made us think that, yes, this is the right moment to invite Douglas Coupland to make the lecture this year was also the publication of the Sternberg Press essay collection Shopping in Jail, Ideas, Essays and Stories for the Increasingly Real 21st Century. Let me just mention one of the bullet points that the editor Schumann Bazar provided, since I could not do this research myself. He had googled together in the introduction a couple of bullet points about Douglas Coupland. Some of them we already heard, but I think it's nice to have them in this form. So this is from that essay collection. So He was born, this is a quote from the book, introduction, he was born on a military base in Germany. This and the fact that his child and early adulthood happened under the Cold War's ambient, tangible threat could be why Apocalypse is never far away from his work. Indeed, in his last novel, Worst Person Ever, there is the main character is involved in dropping an atom bomb on the Pacific trash vortex, which triggers a nuclear crisis. That leads us to the next bullet point, and this is again, I quote what is written. He cites Jenny Holzer's truisms as an impetus to write. He aphorizes effortlessly. In fact, he was effectively tweeting decades before Twitter even began. And through that, we would not have zeitgeisty words like Generation X or MacJob without Douglas Coupland. The last one. He introduced the word smoopid in 2013. It's a fusion of smart and stupid. He constantly invents new words, neologisms, and acronyms. Reality, I reckon, needs to be described before we fully recognize it as reality. Actually, not the last one. It connects to this, that in his biography of McLuhan, he describes this constant habit of wordplay and punning and making acronyms and aphorisms as the results of a brain defect. That's the last bullet point here. He, quote, is the heir apparent of McLuhan for the internet and now post-internet world. So, Doug, please, the stage is finally yours. Welcome.
Well, Christopher, thanks. That was very gracious. It's a pleasure to be here. I feel like I'm in a high school gymnasium in Whitehorse in the Northwest Territories. We've got our Haida jazz hands here on the wall behind me here. Above me on the screen in rapid rotation, that's a series of photos I did back in 2002 titled Trash That Only Canadians Will Understand. So for all of you who are not from Canada, you probably won't get it. It's a secret handshake. Tonight, I'm in an unusual situation where there's a hair going sideways in my left nostril and it is driving me crazy. So I'm going like this a lot. That's called too much information. It's a pleasure to be here, Ambassador. Thank you. And thanks for Christopher and everyone at the Transmediale Festival. I'm happy that this speech is to be in the spirit of McLuhan. As a public speaker, he was actually kind of random and go off in tangents all the time, which is what I do, so I think I'm in luck here tonight. When we talk about digital trash, in a way, we're discussing the unintended side effects of information and its delivery system. As my nephew says, the thing about the internet, it's like when you pee in a swimming pool. You can't get it back out of the pool afterwards. There are these weird after effects and unintended effects that you get. Someone was showing me an article in a paper version of the Frankfurter Allgemeine Zeitung. I hope I'm pronouncing that properly. And I was looking at the words on the paper, and I kept waiting for them to automatically translate into English for me. About a year ago, I was watching Mr. Goodbar, starring Richard Gere and Diane Keaton. And it was set in 1970s New York. And what was horrifying wasn't so much the violent death at the end. What was horrifying was that people back then lived in these sort of really badly furnished caves that were connected by landlines. And going watching that movie is like time travel, a form of sort of ecotourism of the mind. Back in the 1970s, when I was sort of formed, we had maybe 10 memes a year, if we were lucky. We had Pet Rocks or the Bermuda Triangle or Pyramid Power. And these days, if you want to, you can burn through 100 memes in a day. They're all out there. And it seems to me that the consumption of memes is somehow become a metabolic function. And we're beginning to learn the unexpected limits of our ability to metabolize information these days. Smoopid, which is the word which Christopher mentioned, which my friend Schumann mentioned, that is the feeling that permeates our culture right now, that we've never been smarter, but we've never felt stupider. And I think, you know, when we talk about the future, I think my main thinking about the future, it's going to feel like you left your telephone at home all day and you have this sort of separation anxiety, but you're not quite sure what you're separate from. Marshall McLuhan, 5 years back, I was dragged kicking and screaming to do a book on McLuhan for Penguin. The editor was John Ralston Saul, who's a Canadian, is a public thinker, a public intellectual. And he kept on pushing me, and I kept saying no, and because I had really no idea who McLuhan was or what he had written or what his ideas were, aside from the usual cliches, which are the medium is the message and the global village. And then John ultimately said I should write it because I was, in fact, a manifestation of his theories. And I wasn't sure if that was a put down or a put up, but it did make me curious enough to take the job. So I went from 0 to 100 with McLuhan, starting with the Gutenberg galaxy. Oh, this is another thing. When I'm talking in public, I get dry mouth. I don't know why. And the only other time I get it is when I'm going through customs. And I think psychologically it has something to do, like I'm feeling like I'm being judged. Again, too much information. So I started reading Gutenberg Galaxy. And what happened was you had in Toronto in 1960 this crusty old buddy-duddy who, through a chain of circumstances that can never be repeated ever again, was able to figure out what the internet was decades before it actually became a reality. But to describe the internet, he was using Finnegan's Wake and Homeric poetry, and he was trying with these sort of strange metaphors and adjectives to describe what ultimately became Google, eBay, Amazon, and the entire digital world. And he was unable to describe the physical interfaces, but also he was able to tell us the overall social changes that were going to be wrought by these technologies. So everything from Arab Spring to flash mobs to Breaking Bad, suddenly turning television into a true art form. So I was very lucky to be able to be writing that biography after the internet had made his prescience very clear. Last year I had a book come out with Sternberg Press here in Germany called Shopping in Jail. And today I'm gonna read a few modified pieces that come from it. But one of the things that I think that Christopher, who spoke before me, was talking about it was part of an essay I wrote on Ed Ruscha, a California painter, and it involved being in Los Angeles in 1995. First I was in San Francisco working at Wired in 95, and we were doing a special issue on the future, and one of my topics was the future of garbage. And I was and remain interested in garbage because of the time shifting that is intrinsic to trash. The moment you declare an object to be garbage, it suddenly enters the past tense. It's no longer in the present. It becomes archaeology instantly. And because it's only garbage, you don't really overthink the trashing process. So you can often find very interesting trash portraits of a person simply by looking at what they discard. And thinking of garbage is very different than thinking about the future. The moment you start thinking about the world in front of you as being in the future, our current world is revealed in a radiant new light, sort of like wearing 3D or infrared glasses. So then to be from the perspective of looking at trash from the future, it was like a sort of a temporal double whammy. It is strange being up here, and you're flipping through paper, and it's kind of like having a very visible stroke in public. I'm going to start out with some sort of the trash of the internet is data. It's the data that we create, and sort of the feelings that it puts in all of our heads, and the experiences it gives us all in common. I have a question. Have you ever wondered what it would be like or what it would smell like if you took every cologne and perfume in the world and mixed them all together in a big vat. And you already know the answer. It's called a duty-free shop. Now, I've always hated the term duty-free, and it's not like I'm political, but there's something sort of irresponsible about the term duty-free. Like, you're getting something for free, except it's not really free. Instead, it's someone else is paying for your loot. And I've actually never bought anything duty-free in my life, and it doesn't make me a better person or a political person. It may actually be a scientific indicator of cluelessness, but shopping for duty-free is one of those doors I don't want to open because once it's open, I can't close it again, like Ouija boards or shoplifting or cocaine. I used to have a summer job at one of those stores in the tourist part of town where you give them your name and they go into a large book and magically I find your family crest, which we can ship to you at your own house at a nonsensically high price. And most heraldry is nonsense, but it's very comforting nonsense. And after a month, my boss told me that when people travel, their sense of self, it begins to erode, and they need to purchase something, anything, to shore up their sense of identity, which is why they sell those stickers at airports, like, kiss me, I'm Irish, or... Once I learned the cynicism behind the job, I actually felt creepy, and I moved on. Other thoughts about travel. I was in China last year, and I ran out of clothes to the point where I had to buy a new shirt at the airport if I was even going to make the 10-hour flight back to Canada. So I chose a Lacoste shirt from a boutique there that cost pretty much the same as a Lacoste shirt cost anywhere in the world. And once in flight, I realized that I'd purchased the only authentic piece of designer clothing in China. Now, the thing about China is that everything's fake. And if you want something that looks kind of Chinesey, it's better to go to your own town's local Chinatown and get your stuff there because it's faster, cheaper, and it's probably what you wanted in the first place. And in the end, I ended up collecting cigarettes because Chinese tobacco packaging is really quite beautiful, imperial yellows and reds and blues. And it doesn't have great big, scary, ugly health markings on them. We did a TV show a few years back, and we had to come up with fake warning labels on cigarette packaging. And the one we came up with is smoking is nature's way of killing popular people. Anyhow, so I collected 64 different packs of cigarettes, framed them all, put them up on the wall in my studio. And then my art dealer brought a Chinese collector by to visit. And this guy was sort of stone-faced and didn't really engage with anything until he saw the cigarettes. And then a switch flipped and he became really animated and fun. And he began discussing the class implications of each brand of cigarette. Like, those ones are for bureaucrats, and those ones are for people who drive Audi A6s, and those ones are for peasants. And he got so excited about them that I just sold him the cigarettes. And in some magic way, that transaction became a shorthand for almost the entire world of art and art collecting. I live in Vancouver, where we used to have just one Chinatown, but now we have quite a few Chinatowns depending on what kind of Chinese you are. Taiwanese, Northern Chinese, Shanghaiese. Is that Shanghaiese? Shanghai? Doug, let it go. Hong Kongese, Singaporean, and most of these Chinese people are kind of embarrassed by the old-fashioned Chinatown, which unwittingly and charmingly fosters a kind of Suzy Wong, Marines on shore leave kind of 1962 vibe, which I kind of love, but I suspect the 21st century Vancouver Chinese person would rather be identified by a 2014 S500 Mercedes sedan instead of a strand of paper lanterns. And in any event, the Suzy Wong Chinatown is now being raised to make way for condominium towers, and that's what makes Vancouver Vancouver, is that every 10 years it becomes a completely different city. Airports and travel. I fly more than most people, and in any event, I have to congratulate the Hong Kong Shanghai Bank of China for targeting what is probably the single most potent metaphor for globalization, which is the airport jetway ramp, and for branding a piece of infrastructure in a kick-ass manner that really hasn't been seen since Lady Bird Johnson championed the Highway Beautification Act of 1965. For a few years, HSBC had a campaign for most of us saw over years was a smart, stupid, stupid, smart, love, hate, hate, love, and so on. But now they've got this new campaign in the jet ramps where they show corn made out of textiles that have been knitted, and Hereford cows who have shapes or patches on their skin shaped like continents. And it's just really creepy. And it kind of reinforces my biggest worries about globalization, that it's boring, it's alienating, and it's controlled by technocratic elites who feel sorry for you for having to fly commercial, not private, and that any resistance to their decreed future is futile. Now, here's something I read online. Shortly after the Soviet Union collapsed, a Russian bureaucrat traveled to the West to seek advice on how the market system functioned, and he asked the English economist Paul Sebright to explain who was in charge of the bread supply of London. And he was astonished by the answer, which was nobody, obviously. And in bread capitalism, everything from wheat fertilizers to brioche-making night classes is done by private initiative. But if, in the end, the ownership of the bread industry or any other industry globalizes to the point where there are only one or two players, then aren't we right back at a sort of default Soviet system where the supply of bread, or what you have, is so centralized as to be crypto-communist, and in this new system, both power and profit go to the 1%, which is sort of the new Politburo. And what is their shield? The shield of the 1% is that globalization is so boring, people fall asleep before they can articulate the issue. Boringness is the superpower of globalization. Globalization kills you, but before it does so, it puts you to sleep. Now, getting more into the territory of data and junk data and trace data and things you leave behind, I am going to ask you all to imagine that you are going out on a date with yourself. And not a sexy date, you're just going out for coffee with yourself. You're going to be meeting yourself somewhere neutral and non-stalkery, like a Starbucks or a Cafe Nero. And you'll do it around 11 o'clock in the morning, which science will someday prove is the least sexual time of the day. But let me be clear here. You won't be going on a date with someone with identical DNA to yours, not your twin, not your triplet. Rather, you're going to go on a date with the one person on Earth whom some super intelligent computer has picked to be your date, the one person on Earth who is, in as many modes as possible, identical to you. This pre-selected date might be much older, much younger, or way richer than you, but that's actually doubtful because chances are you'd be nearly identical in age, history, income, musical taste, and of course, it's a very long list. You might possibly even be an opposite gender, but probably not, because this computer's only matchmaking criterion is to locate the one person on Earth who most completely and totally resembles you in IQ, politics, religion, morality, sexual taste, humor, childhood experience, adulthood experiences, and pretty much everything else. So chances are your date is going to be the same sex as you. So how would your date with yourself go? And it's not self-flattery to think that you probably like yourself greatly. For example, I mean, this is someone you don't have to explain anything to. They already know you. They practically are you. And think of all the things you could recommend to each other and all the things you could warn each other away from, movies and businesses and churches and foods and countries and hotels and other people. But on the other hand, what if you met yourself and instead it was just kind of boring? I mean, there's only so much you can look into a mirror before life moves on. So maybe you'd come away from your meeting with yourself shrugging and saying, well, that was kind of interesting. But much more plausibly, you might come away from your encounter kind of disgusted by yourself. It's human nature to dislike in others the traits you see in. It's human nature to dislike in others the traits that you dislike in yourself. And this would certainly be the test. But the silver lining here is that you'd quickly learn all the things about yourself that you need to fix. So your date would be a self-help blessing in disguise. But let's push it further. What if this crazy, smart supercomputer also introduced you to the next 10 people as similar to you as possible? Collectively, the dozen of you would actually be just one person, more or less spread out equally amongst 12 bodies. And chances are you'd probably get along quite well, maybe you'd all move in together. You could become a cult house. Like, ooh, it's those scary people who all think and believe exactly alike. Stay away from that place. Let's go further. Still, what if the computer selected the 1,000 people just like you, or the 10,000 people? What number would you draw the line at? Nah, that person is just too different from me. Criminal proclivities, dull conversationalist, kinky stuff, opposite gender. But then here's an idea. What if, say, you were having a personal crisis and you genuinely needed some good advice from yourself? Who better to seek counsel from than your calm, detached doppelgangers? You would basically crowdsource personal issues and ideas alone. Let's go to the next level. What if the date-making computer selected the 51% of the people in your country most like you? You could get together and form a political party, and you'd have very little dissent amongst yourselves. The you party would instantly win. You rule. But at what point do you draw the line in identity? Left wing versus right? Beatles fans versus Stones fans? Atheist versus theist? Chocolate versus vanilla? Now, a discussion like this sounds like a parlor game in the year 2014, but in 20 years, trillions of petabytes of memory and speed at your fingertips will allow you to find your spiritual doppelgangers with an app that you probably get bored of in a few days. If Google has taught us anything, it is how cavalierly people become blasé with even the most astonishing technologies. So in the future, voting is going to morph into something else altogether. If people are even still going to the ballot box, you'll be able to look at them, scan them really, and tell how many of them took an elevator that day, whether or not they pushed the door close button, what color shirt they had on, how many voters they interacted with that day, and transcript of almost everything that they've said available on demand. There will be key search words allowing you to find intuitively whether any of them were planning on having sex that night or buying laundry detergent. And then you could find the square root of every phone number that everyone on Earth during the last 15 minutes had dialed. And you get the point here, that there's pretty much infinite amounts of data and infinite numbers of ways you can tinker with it. And so the largest question here regarding voting is who will decide the definition of the new 51%? What criteria and algorithms are going to be used? Because this is the true future of voting. It's dating yourself. We're going to go a bit further into memory and the growth of memory. A few years back in Santa Clara, California, I saw a strip mall with a sign that read, Bulk Memory Sale. And I think there's actually something kind of sexy about memory being sold in bulk, like chocolate or raisins or bottles of pesto at Costco. It's like you can buy a whole new childhood or a set of new family relationships. Now, the California sign I saw, aside from being charming though, it made me realize just how different memory is now versus what memory was, say, 50 years ago or even 20 years ago. Memory now means more than just organic memory inside your brain or the secrets in your diary tucked beneath your pillow. Memory now means what you have in your laptop and all of your devices. It now also includes everything you've got stored in the cloud. Most importantly, it also includes everything on the internet, and you, like it or not, are intimately embedded in the internet. Andy Warhol believed that in Manhattan, all the Chinese restaurants had just one big jumbo super kitchen underneath Manhattan, and they all got their food from the same kitchen. In a way, your memory, my memory, our memory is now kind of like Andy Warhol's mythical Chinese food kitchen. Because we all get our information now from the same kitchen, and there's just one menu, and it's called the same internet for everyone on Earth. So if you were to take someone who's not been on the internet, and suddenly you put them on the internet, and I'm just going to say a guy who herds yaks in rural Tibet. That's really hard to say. A yak herder in rural Tibet. Well, we're stuck with him. So you give this guy the same connectivity, and he'll access the same memory bank that you do, but instead of going to yaks.com, he's probably going to kill time reading, and he'll start reading those really bitter, scary, one-star hotel reviews in TripAdvisor.com. Or maybe you'll get caught in a cute puppy warp on YouTube, or you'll go binging on TED Talks, but to be honest, you'll probably just be checking out the porn. Am I being judgmental here? No, and if I am, it's only going to be a positive judgment. It's the last thing planet Earth right now needs, is 6.5 billion people being outside wrecking things. It's actually all for the better, and technically quite green, that everyone is instead inside YouTubing Russian dash cam compilations. I've always, as I've said, been interested in the unintended side effects of technology. For example, when the automobile was invented, who would have thought that dogs like sticking their head out the windows to enjoy the scentscape that is generated by speed and wind? And likewise, I think about the unintended side effects of all of humanity ordering from the same identical memory Chinese soup kitchen. People are people, and everyone's going to be looking for the same thing. I'm having a stroke again in public. Ah, okay, I'm back on track. Doug's back. People are people. And everyone's going to be looking for the same things pretty much regardless of culture. Of course, sometimes on Earth you find localized clamps on what you may and may not be able to find online. I was in Beijing a year ago, and I put a question or search word in the Google box, and instead of the normal 0.128 seconds, after about 15 seconds or so, you get an answer, if you get one at all. And also, if you go to the Emirates, you probably won't be able to find anything frisky if you go looking for things there. And what I'm finding fascinating here is that the internet bends you to its will, regardless of who you are or where you are. And it neurologically rewires you. In fact, the way the internet homogenizes the human brain is nothing short of astounding, and we are now actually all hitting the point where your human neural patterns are becoming globally similar to a level that possibly hasn't been achieved since the last ice age, when a handful of hardy souls survived their way through the cold by sitting in a cave telling the same stories over and over again. Now, this homogenization of human thinking, it's an elective process brought about by the internet's undeniable quality and quantity of information, as well as the insane speed at which it arrives. And these three factors are in turn brought about by eerily consistent logarithmic increases in memory storage and accessibility and processing speed and power. Well, it's that bulk memory we saw for sale in Santa Clara, California. And can you hop off this new memory express when you want? Well, no, there's really no turning back, because speed and memory are irreversibly addictive. And the only enemy in this strange new turf is probably the paywall, but I'm sure they'll be crumbling someday soon everywhere. So the future is an infinity of links to cute kitten gifts, Doctor Who reruns, and online gambling. And are we smarter as a result of all this speed and memory, or are we stupider? It's probably a moot point. Never in human history has nostalgia been as useless or as uncomforting as it is right now. And I'm not even talking about nostalgia for the decade that you grew up in. I'm talking about nostalgia for 5 years ago, or 3 years ago, or before Twitter. But let me ask you, would you go back to your 2002 laptop or your 1998 dial-up online service? Doubtful. We seem to have made a trade. And in any event, in 15 years, you will be able to go to download, you'll be able to go download the entire internet onto something the size of a box of Marlboros, sort of like Microsoft's Dune Encarta times 50 trillion. And this means you won't even actually have to go online to go online. Basically, everyone on Earth will have the sum of humanity's accumulated knowledge on them at all times. And what's this going to feel like? Well, knowing how ungrateful human beings are, as a species, we'll probably be bored with all this new technology and start getting ourselves into trouble, and then our machines will become sentient and start feeling sorry for us, and then they'll start killing us because we probably deserve it. I sound pessimistic. And some days I am pessimistic. And some days I despair for individuals. And some days I despair for humanity in bulk. Well, I guess that is the role of being an atomized individual in the global village. I mean, let's face it, nobody ever phones up someone else and says, like, hey, come on over to my house and we'll go online together. Going online is an astonishingly isolating activity, and yet for an activity that's so incredibly isolating, it has an astonishing power to create groups and new groups. You know, some days you feel like a cat, and you just want to go and roam the internet alone and be fierce, hiding your search history behind you as you go forward. And some days you feel like a dog and you just want to connect with all of humanity with emails and Facebook or whatever else it is you're doing. And one of the great riddles of our day is whether the internet is ultimately going to favor the group, the global village, or if it's going to favor the individual. Again, Arab Springs versus people internet trolling all alone. And well, beyond this, what I've just discussed, there's actually another way in which individuality can pluralize. And to understand this, I'd like you to meet a friend, and my friend's name is Todd. Now, here's an idea. Let's say you install an app in your laptop or your phone, and let's call this app Todd. And what Todd does is he monitors your emails and memos and documents. And in so doing, Todd learns about you, the words you tend to use, the words you misspell. If you're having your period, your friend's birthdays, Todd is useful. Todd stops you from making errors, and he gently corrects you and makes you a better person along the way. Now, because you like Todd, you pay extra an upgrade to Todd Premium. And now Todd starts getting a more detailed, he gets more detailed in his analysis of you. It's where and when you shop, the pharmaceuticals and illegal drugs you take, the way you communicate with your parents or children, the sorts of things that can actually be construed using relatively simple algorithms. No more embarrassing slip-ups. And what's that? There's a sale in my favorite Chilean Chardonnay on Sainsbury's. Olé. So Todd is actually proving to be a sound addition to your life, but soon Todd is no longer something you just download on your phone or laptop. By now, Todd's just out in the cloud somewhere, and that's fine. But because as years go by and computer speed grows and memory grows logarithmically, Todd has now gone from being an app to becoming a sort of personal butler slash parallel you. Todd starts fielding your dullest emails automatically. He makes your morning coffee and alarms your house while you're abroad. He really gets you. Now, a few years later from now, in the near future, you get an email from Todd saying, you know what, let's put your face on me. So through a simple 3D rotational scan at a local tech boutique, you can make Todd look just like you on screen. With alarmingly accurate facial animation, you are Todd and Todd is you. And at this point, there can't be much he doesn't know about you. He's seen everything you've ever put into a search engine. He knows which friends you're avoiding. He knows about your sex life. Todd knows who you voted for and what you really think about the afterlife. And not only this, he has instantaneous total recall of where and when everything you ever did happened. Oh yeah, and he's also part of the internet. So Todd is now you, in effect your doppelganger, except he's more than that, he's your cloud ganger. Now, to some extent, finding your cloud ganger already exists. People just haven't figured out how to access and harvest from existing data streams, and 3D imaging, while very good, is still prohibitively expensive. But it is an absolute certainty that within 2 decades, you will have a cloud ganger. You will have your own Todd. Now, the amount of data that we are spewing out into the universe these days is expanding logarithmically. And telecommunications experts unanimously agree that the future of data isn't you and me sending more emails to each other or downloading more movies. The future is probably machines talking to other machines, and what they're going to be talking about is you. How much you spent on chewing gum in the past decade, how much you pee, the color of your urine, the politicians you're slamming, which species of puppy you find the cutest. That's the sexy stuff. They'll also be talking to each other about your carbon footprint, what sorts of people you trust or mistrust, what ideas bore you. And in a way, it's sort of like eHarmony.com, except instead of 29 levels of intimacy, there are an infinite number of levels. Now let us brutally discuss the cloud. 10 years ago, the cloud didn't exist, and now it is it inarguably constitutes the largest entity our species have ever created. But the cloud isn't just a fluffy blob sort of floating over Manhattan. The blob is made of an almost staggeringly boring and unimaginably complex assembly of wires, routers, switches, and storage drives spread around the planet, usually in big boring structures in the dullest part of the town you live in. And there is simply no way of making the cloud sexy. Brad Pitt is never going to star in the movie version of the cloud. Nobody would or could star in the movie version of the cloud. The movie version would be a 24-hour nanny cam in the ceiling of a data containment vault number 7 in the Google mothership in the Dale, Oregon. But back to you, back to your cloud ganger. At this point, we're now a bit more in the future, and you're not the only one out there who's got a Todd. 8 billion people at that point have a Todd in their life. And because computer speed and memory are 100 trillion times faster when you first signed up for Todd Premium, he's become a genuine virtual version of you who exists out there with all the other virtual people. So imagine there's a large room with two boxes in it. Your mother is sitting in a chair in front of these two boxes, and she's told that one of them contains you and one of them contains your cloud ganger. And that by talking with each of these boxes, she has to figure out which is an elaboration of the Turing box. But also, your cloud ganger is hooked up to a vocalizer, and he speaks just like you. And it wouldn't be long before the real you and your cloud ganger would be arguing with each other, trying to convince your mother that you're the real one. And in the end, she wouldn't know the difference, and that's the start of it. Your cloud ganger is actually going to be a tapeworm, like a trillion bits long. He'll be every email you've ever sent, everything you've ever purchased, your medical history, everywhere you've ever been in front of a camera, your dating patterns, your child-rearing patterns, your voice, your inflections, the way you make typos. And that is an added bonus. Todd is connected to Google, Wikipedia, and the ARPANET and Al Jazeera and every other data trove on Earth. So the only real difference between you and your cloud ganger, aside from the fact that you're made of meat and it isn't, is that it's just a quadrillion times smarter than you. It knows the 18th root of pi. It knows the cube root of every book written in the 19th century. And if you could attach your cloud ganger to a biometrically super accurate ultra Pixar version of your body, not at that point, even your corporeal meat becomes kind of a quibble. Because after a point, and you saw this coming, you and Todd start to diverge. There's a real you and there's the Todd you. Except you're getting old and Todd is ageless. In fact, he gets richer and denser with information in tandem with the entire computing universe. Your face looks like crap, but Todd hasn't aged at all. Well, his face is actually due to improvements in rendering software, about as real as a real face can look, except it's an idealized, perpetually young version of you. You're going to be dead soon. Dogs last 12 years, cats 15, and humans go for about 77. Now, a lot of things could happen at this point. You could erase Todd, except you can't. He's permanent. Your cloud ganger could go to war with another cloud ganger and kill it to feast on stored data. Your cloud ganger, well, maybe he or she could merge with other cloud gangers. Your cloud ganger could make a billion copies of himself or herself, if it so wished. And in my head, I'm seeing this whole planet covered by crackling Tesla waves of electricity, and every person born since 1910 coexisting at once, arguing and solving crossword puzzles and yakking away incessantly, or maybe they're not. Since the missing ingredient here is sentience, that magic moment when the spark of life, self-awareness, leaves the human body and it enters the cloud and it becomes free to roam the planet with its own agenda. And the most logical place for it to adapt and make expressions of itself is to hijack cloud gangers, yours perhaps. Now, time moves on. Todd's actually kind of bored by you. you haven't done anything interesting in decades, and he could practically script out the remainder of your days with chillingly molecular accuracy. So while you're asleep, Todd screws around and briefly turns himself into a computer-generated owl flying through a cybernetic forest, or a CAD model of an automatic transmission from a 1974 Ford Cortina, or a real-time map of Antarctic weather patterns. And like a teenager, Todd starts hanging out with other Todds, and with nearly infinite levels of speed and memory, they begin talking about you, and they start making fun of you, and they compare profiles and joke about how statistically boring you are. And after the cyber equivalent of learning to smoke cigarettes and having sloppy sex, Todd decides to dump you. You wake up one morning and like, WTF? Todd is shacked up with another Todd, and they've fused, and he's gone. Your cloud ganger has mutinied. You're officially divorced from yourself. And time goes on. The new Todd merges with the Todd cluster from, say, a South American server farm and another in Japan. They rename themselves Heaven's Choice and decide to make a trillion copies of themselves simply because they can. These trillion copies, they wage war with one another. A Todd cluster makes a trillion copies of itself, but it's sort of primitive to wage war, isn't it? These entities realize that, and they stop, and they apologize to each other, and they have a cloud orgy, and then they all merge into one great big cosmic unitod. Now, we're conditioned to view sentience, or the singularity, the unitod, as a more or less friendly HAL 9000-like entity with the voice of a country doctor, or perhaps the voice of a wise mother cooing to a newborn child, but I find that very hard to imagine. Like anything alive, sentience must first exist embryonically, which is what today's electronic world really is. It's a womb, and then one day, sentience will be born. It will have an infancy and an adolescence and a mature life, but I find it very hard to believe that something newly born would, right out of the gate, see as its first and overriding goal as being the bringing about of the golden age of humanity. I think instead, sentience, when it emerges, will do the cyber equivalent of shed its diapers and scream for attention, and it's probably not going to be very much fun. And the only real physical need of this ultimate unitod is a technological apparatus maintained by humans to maintain the wires and transmitters and routers and satellites and fibers. And does he or she get nostalgic for the old you? No, they do not. But the question here, is, you have the ultimate alloy of human souls who will most probably span 200 or 300 years of our existence until becoming a completely full reality. You'll have an entity that will embody every conceivable aspect of humanity, all of it multiplying itself infinitely, and it will come to conclusion we can never come close to dream of articulating. But you have to ask yourself, in understanding the true magnificence of Todd, whether the biological you was merely just a necessary transitional step for the universe to arrive at a sort of secular God with its own form of secular transcendence. So I guess the point of all this is that Todd is in you, and Todd is all around you, and he's certainly in your trash can, and he will one day transcend you. Kind of spooky, isn't it? Thank you very much. I think that's what I'm going to say for tonight. Christopher is now going to come up on stage, the preternaturally young-looking Christopher. And we're going to sit down, have a little bit of a talk, and then I think we're going to do some question and answer. Is that correct? So please come on up. Thanks. Hello. Jan, are these turned on? Is this on? That's always like, this mic's turned off, isn't it? Those are very famous last words.
So, yeah, thank you, Doug. The question, I guess, is, are you Doug or are you Todd? Well.
Todd, I think Todd means death in German. I just think, for a guy in North America, I think the the three funniest names you can have are Todd, Kevin, or Greg. And I think Greg and Kevin were taken, hence Todd.
So, I beg to disagree about the... you're right that Brad Pitt won't star in the Cloud Ganger movie, but actually Tom Cruise already starred in it. It's called Oblivion. And in this movie, a cloud entity produces copies of Tom Cruise that it inhabits Earth in its last apocalyptic days.
Who won?
Tom Cruise. He went then back to nature and killed all the cloud gangers. But the question that I would like to pose in relation to that has to do with McLuhan, actually. Because in that kind of movie, in that kind of sci-fi scenario, you have like a dystopia, and then you have like, we kill off the technology and go back to nature. And McLuhan had a deep conservatism, and I think you deal with this also in your biography. He was actually quite skeptical about the technological advancements that he wrote about. What affinities do you have to McLuhan's positions in that regard? And am I right to assume that you replace his conservatism with a kind of cool irony?
Well, McLuhan had one thing, a permanent sense of what's called Christmas morning syndrome, which is you always feel like something is about to, magnificent is about to be revealed at any moment, that at any moment you're going to see the contents of the ark. And he actually went through that his entire life, and he was a very religious man. He went to Mass once a day. He converted later in life. And because of that, he was able to be quite clinically detached from the things he felt strongly about versus the things he theorized about. From what I can read, he was quite disgusted by the modern world, didn't like the way it was going at all, thought pollution was going to be the end of the planet. But he never editorialized about what he theorized about. I think that's maybe a bit of what you're talking about. Was he political? I don't know. I mean, okay, you go to visit your parents, and okay, what are the things we can't talk about with mom and dad? And like anyone of a certain age, there are all these topics about you couldn't go with Marshall, and I'm probably gonna be the same way when I'm older. Rephrase the last part of that question, ironic detachment.
Yeah, I'm just, I was asking also about your relation to when you also talk about technological development, and on the one side you have like a little bit like celebration of these developments, but you also have this, maybe it's a writer's irony, you know, that it's like your own kind of detachment or relationship to technological development your earlier work to today.
I oscillate completely between end of the world and utopia. There's no middle ground for me. It's either the best or the worst. It really is. And I think a lot of that, the dystopic part of me comes absolutely from growing up in a military Cold War family in the 60s and 70s. You know, and also, I mean, my father and my brothers are all gun nuts, and I grew up in this house surrounded by like weapons and rifles, of anything you can imagine everywhere. Photographs of my dad flying a jet. And my brother is a taxidermist, so there's dead animals everywhere all over the house. And I just really grew up sort of surrounded by death on every level. And I thought, okay, when I'm an adult, I'm gonna escape this family hillbilly curse, and I'm gonna live in a great big modern house and pretend I didn't have the upbringing I had. And so I got a modern house, and I began collecting art, and being quite self-satisfied, like, yes, no more hillbilly he. And then a friend pointed out that all the art I did collect was about the military and death and destruction, and basically I just taken the things I felt comfortable with and, you know, brought them up to date, basically. And once she pointed that out, I thought, you know, dang, you're right. So I got rid of everything that didn't have to do with death and destruction. It actually makes, so if you come to my house, which I hope you will do one day, you'll walk in, it'll just be Star Wars fighter cruisers. There's a print of an F-111 fighter jet going across the room. And anything I do have that resembles portraiture looks like it's been stuffed. So what I'm saying here is that even when you try, you think analytically, you think you've like overcome things that happened to you when you're young or your family experience, you can't. It's always there. In fact, it just makes itself more manifested more awkwardly and weirdly as time goes on. You'll see.
I could ask many more questions. I have some written down, but I think we're already quite far ahead in our time schedule, that it would be nice also to maybe open up the floor to some questions from the audience. If you don't mind.
Yes, I was going to say the first question is the lucky question. There you go. Hello.
There is a microphone that you will get. So, mic runner.
Thanks. I'm just curious about the statement you just made. You said you oscillate from utopia to dystopia. So I'm curious about what maybe in the last 10, 15 years were developments or moments where you felt where your outlook was utopic?
The two moments that really sort of stand out in my mind just in the last few years, do you use an iPhone or Android? What do you use?
iPhone, yeah.
Okay, on iPhone, there's a thing called Shazam, which you turn it on, and whatever song's playing, it tells you what it is, who recorded it, do you want to buy it, here's some art, and, you know, articles connected to it. And like, I mean, that just my head is like, you know, my brain dribbled out my ears. And the second thing was Angelina Jolie getting a preemptive mastectomy, which thought was like fantastically futuristic and advanced and smart. And I think that I was trying to reduce things to the most absolute mundane level. If you go to the grocery store near where I live, I grew up with, there's one kind of mushroom, it was called a button mushroom, and they were all the same size, and now you go to anywhere, they got 12 different kinds of mushroom. My 12-year-old niece, she was doing a homework project on genetically modified organisms, and like, oh, can I read it? Like, oh, no, you don't have to, it's on YouTube. And like, and there's this 10-minute documentary she's made just as a matter of course on genetically modified corn. I think that no matter what, I think the present is always a better place than the past. And, oh boy. Whatever unit of measurement you use, human beings are just one iota more good than they are bad. It's kind of like Pandora's box, but it keeps me going. Also, you weren't alive during the 70s by the look of you. No, there was like these movies with Charlton Heston in them, like Omega Man and Planet of the Apes. And there was nothing else on, so that was the only movie you could watch, and it just really went deeply, and it just made you Soylent Green, just made the whole future just this place that scared the crap out of you. And I know, I think the future is a bit more interesting cinematically these days. I hope that was an answer to your question, sir. Thank you.
That was great, thanks.
Are there more questions?
Something I'd like to do,
yeah.
And I'm trying to figure out if we can do it here. Back in 2002, I did a book. It was called Hey Nostradamus. And it was looking at the lens of a high school shooting through theology. And I was doing research, and in the Columbine High School, after the shooting, because the way that propane bombs were spread throughout the school, the switch that operated the fire alarm system for the school, they couldn't turn it off until around midnight when they finally got in. The FBI and the police going through the building suddenly the alarm went off and all these backpacks had been left in the cafeteria and all the cell phones were lying on the tables and lying on the floor. And everyone was trying to phone each other, and the FBI agent said it sounded just like tropical birds when all these phones were going off at once. So what I'm kind of wondering here is the wonderful thing you can do with an audience when everyone has a smartphone is how do we do a little impromptu performance of tropical birds here in the audience tonight? I'm wondering, do you telephone the person next to you? Can we do that? I'll phone you. So, how do you get your ringer to work? You won't give me your number? Okay, hang on. Plus 0049. Oh, shit. Right, how do you make that go back? Fuck off. Ah, hang on. Okay. Well, I think that's a lovely, actually really beautiful little moment here that I think I'm going to say goodnight and say thank you to the embassy and Transmediale for having this wonderful event. I think we're having cocktails and laughter and madness outside in the area out there. So I'll join you there. Thanks very much for coming tonight, Berlin, Germany.